And when he was gone forth into the way, there came a root running and kneeled to him, and asked him, Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And Jesus said unto him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments, Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not hear false witness. And he answered and said unto him, Master, all these things have I observed. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, One thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast given to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven, and take up thy cross and follow me. And he was sad that saying, and went away grieved. And Jesus said, Look around about, saith unto his disciples, How hardly shall they that have riches enter the kingdom of God? So Paul uses this kind of argument, showing that, number one, it doesn't say that Jesus is God. Number two, doesn't even teach atonement. And the argument there is, the Lord is just challenging the heart of the man. The man's heart was not right. The man's heart was not resting in God, but in his own righteousness. And there were certain things that he was holding on to. But if you read later on in the chapter, it says, verse 32, And they were in the way going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus went before them, and they were amazed, and as they followed, they were afraid. And he took again, saying, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be delivered unto the chief priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death, and deliver him up to the Gentiles. And they shall mock him, and shall scourge him, and shall spit upon him, and shall kill him. And the third day he shall rise again. So, you know, Paul is saying that, number one, the Lord Jesus didn't know anything, and so he couldn't have been God. Here, the Lord knows what the future is going to be. He's going to get crucified. Number two, Paul is saying that, you know, it's about good works you're saved, and yet the Lord is talking about his death, that is, you know, that he's going to die, and he's dying as the Son of Man. He's dying as a Savior, okay? And thirdly, Paul is saying that this passage doesn't teach about God, Jesus being God, but Jesus uses the word Son of Man. And the word Son of Man, when he's using it, is referred to Daniel 7, where the Ancient of Days, who is God, the Son of Man is called the Ancient of Days, and comes in the glory and to be worshipped. Only God is to be worshipped. So, looking at the chapter and the context of a chapter, you can get a better understanding. But Paul will ask you a question and corner you on a particular passage, and not give you room to maneuver and to look at things in a more in the context. So that's an example of this kind of apologetics that some of these Muslim apologists use. They use eisegesis rather than exegesis. They take bits of verses here to prove their point without looking at the context and without actually looking at all the text as well. And just to say that, you know, there are verses that say that Jesus didn't know anything. There are verses that say Jesus knew things beforehand. And we have an understanding of that, Christian theologians. If you turn to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, it says, verse 5, Let this mind be in you, which was in Christ Jesus, who, sharing of being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself no reputation, took upon himself the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth, and that things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Here it's saying that he thought it not robbery to be, it says that, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So there is saying that he's equal with God, which is a statement of saying he's God. But then it says, but made himself of no reputation. So the Lord, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. So he became a man and became a servant. And in that servanthood, there was a certain limitation put upon him. He was going to suffer for sinners. He was going to die. All right? And there's a mystery there. There's a mystery in it. But because he became a servant, he was limited in that sense. So the divine part of the human side of Jesus was limited at certain times for his mission. And that's how we understand it from Philippians chapter 3. It's not limiting God, but the man. And that's important. God cannot be limited in the sense that God knows all things. But the man, in his mind, was not able to fully understand sometimes things because the God part would not reveal it to the man's side. That's how we understand it in Philippians chapter 2. All right? That's not the kenosis theory. The kenosis theory is that God is limited, but God cannot be limited. So the kenosis theory is wrong. What I'm saying is a different idea, that the man's side was limited at times in his mission as he came to die for us. The idea that Jesus died on a cross and that it was God that died is, again, a misunderstanding of the incarnation. We see it as a mystery. It is a mystery. We don't fully understand how God can become a man. So we say that Jesus is two natures in one. Two natures, the God and man in one person. But when Christ was dying, it was not God that could die. It was the man. The man died, all right? And it's a mystery. We don't fully understand it. But to say that logically you're saying that God died, you're making a logical deduction from a mystery. A mystery, by definition, is something that we cannot logically fully understand. So by using logic and trying to understand something that is infinitely greater than our logic, you're kind of making a straw man argument. All right? So, the other thing as well, I want to just talk about the next point, is about the Trinity. There's no point in talking about the Trinity if you're not going to be open about it. If you're not going to be open about the Trinity, if you're not going to study it, if you just want to get arguments to attack it, then you're going to find arguments to attack it. But you've got to be willing to study. Let's just look at some verses on the Trinity. John chapter 1 verse 18. John chapter 1 verse 18. No man has seen God at any time, the only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he declared him. So that is saying that Jesus is divine there by saying that. Only Jesus knows God. In other words, before the beginning of time, Jesus was there. Titus chapter 2. Verse 13. Titus 2:13. Titus chapter 2. Now the Muslims say, where did Jesus say he was God? Listen, the Bible's the word of God. Wherever it says he's God, that's the Bible. And you can't just say, oh, I'm not going to listen to those things. No, that's a criteria that I don't accept. It's what the Bible says. So your criteria is all wrong. Titus chapter 2 verse 13. Looking for that glorious blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Saviour Jesus Christ. So there it's saying that Jesus is God. Paul is saying Jesus is God. And the glorious appearing of the great God and our Saviour, Jesus Christ. So the two in the Greek there are connected. 2 Peter chapter 1, 1. 2 Peter chapter 1, 1. 2 Peter 1:1, Peter, servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained the precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Saviour Jesus Christ. There, it's emphasis on God, but it's connecting the Saviour Jesus Christ next to God. For a Muslim, for a Jew, that would be blasphemy. Isaiah 9, verse 6. Isaiah 9, verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be on his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. So they're saying the son is going to be called the Father God. Romans 9:5, who are the fathers of whom are concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God, blessed forever. So that is saying that Jesus is God. Who are the fathers of whom are concerning the flesh, Christ came, who is over all, God, blessed forever. Amen. Hebrews 1:8. Hebrews 1:8. But unto the Son he hath, thy throne, O God, is for ever and ever, a sceptre of righteousness, the sceptre of thy kingdom. So the Son is called God. And now, if you want to do a study as Muslims in the Bible, Jesus is called Jehovah in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8 and 12. Compare it with Psalm 102, verse 25 to 27. So if you look at Psalm 102, 25, 27, it talks about Jehovah. And then in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 8 to 12, it talks about Jesus as Jehovah. You can compare Isaiah chapter 6, verse 10, what it says about God, and compare it to what it says about Jesus in John chapter 12, verse 36, 41. Read Psalm 6, verse 18, and compare it with Ephesians 4, verse 7 and 8. Read Isaiah chapter 8, verse 13 and 14, and read Luke chapter 2, 34, 1 Peter chapter 2, 4 and 8, and compare what it says about God and Jesus. Read Joel chapter 2, verse 32, and compare it with Romans 10:19-13. You'll see that Jesus and God are the same. Read Zechariah chapter 12, verse 11 and 10. Read Revelation chapter 1, 7. See what it says about God and Jesus, and they're the same. Read Isaiah 40, verse 3, Malachi chapter 3, verse 3, and then Mark chapter 1, verse 1 to 3, and see what it says about God and about Jesus. They're the same. Read Malachi chapter 3, verse 1, Matthew chapter 11, verse 10, see what it says about God and Jesus. They're the same. Read Numbers 21, 5 and 6, 1 Corinthians 10 and 19, and what it says about God, it says about Jesus. Isaiah 61 and Luke chapter 4, verse 16, 21, what it says about God, it says about Jesus. Isaiah 45, 22 to 23, read with Romans chapter 14 to 11, what it says about God, it says about Jesus. Read chapter Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 24, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 30 to 31, what it says about God, it says about Jesus. Read Psalm 34, verse 8, and read 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 3, what it says about God, it says about Jesus. The I Am statements. The I Am is the name of God in Exodus 3, verse 14, 16. I Am is a statement of God's name in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14 and 16. Jesus uses that same name that God uses for himself. He uses John chapter 8, verse 24, 8, 28, John 13, 19, John 18, 5 and 6, John 8, 58 and 59. Statements about Jesus being God in other parts of Scripture. Read Isaiah 44, verse 6, and compare it with Revelation chapter 1, verse 8, Revelation 1, 17, 18, Revelation 2, verse 8, Revelation 22, 13, 12, and 13. Read Deuteronomy chapter 10, 17, Psalm 136, 1 to 3, Timothy, Revelation 17, 14, Revelation 19, 11, 16. Compare the Old Testament to the Revelation passages and see what it says about God. Jesus is called Saviour, God is called Saviour. Isaiah 43:11, Isaiah 49:26, Isaiah 13:4, all these are references to God being Saviour. Luke 2:11, John 4:42, Acts 5:31, Ephesians 5:23, 2 Timothy 1:10, Titus 1:4, Titus 3:5-6, 2 Peter 1:11, 2 Peter 2:20, 2 Peter 3:18, 1 John 4:14, all these are references to Jesus being Saviour, and yet the same word Saviour is used of God. Jesus shares the glory of God. Isaiah 42:8-11, John 17:5, John 17:24. Jesus is to be worshipped. Only God is to be worshipped. Exodus 34:14. And yet we see people worshipping Jesus. Matthew 4:10, Acts 10:25-26, Revelations 19:10, Revelations 22:8-9, Matthew 14:31-33, Matthew 28:9, Matthew 28:16-17, John 9:35, Hebrews 1:6, Revelations 5:11-14. We're to give Jesus sacred service. Daniel 7:13-14, Psalm 2:11-12, Revelations 22:1-3. We're to pray to Jesus. John 14:13-14, Acts 1:24-25, Acts 7:59-60, 2 Corinthians 12:8-9, Acts 9:13-14, Acts 22:6, Romans 10:12-14, 1 Corinthians 1:2, 1 Corinthians 16:22, Revelation 16:22. God forgives sins. Excuse me, Jesus forgives sins. Mark 2:5-7, Luke 5:22-25. Excuse me. Jesus has full deity. Colossians 1:15. Colossians 2:9-10. Jesus does the works of deity. John 1:3. Jesus has final judgment, is in charge of final judgment. Romans 14:10, etc. So if you're a Muslim and you really want to search, then feel free to look at all those verses about the Trinity and study what the Bible actually says about the Trinity. Okay? I'll just read this testimony. This is a testimony of a Muslim. It's a Muslim who became a Christian. He says, Anis is a Pakistani who received Quranic education as a child and followed the teachings of Muhammad. He attended the mosque 5 times a day and sought to do everything right in the sight of Allah. Now living in London, he tells his story. All my life I wanted to be a fighter against the enemies of Islam. As a young man, I joined the extremist Pakistani army and was about to begin fighting at Kashmir against Indian troops when I received a letter from home telling me my mother was terminally ill. When I got home, I discovered she was suffering from breast cancer and she died just 2 months later. I was devastated. She was so special to me. Soon after this, my headquarters informed me that Western missionaries were spreading Christian ideas around Muslim youth. At that same time, I met with my cousin and found he was reading a New Testament, and I asked him to take me to the person who had given it to him. When I first met Tom Ward, a missionary, I was really angry with him and told him to take these things away and leave and spread his Christianity among his own people. But even though I was so aggressive with him, he was very kind and gentle. He spoke to me like a father to a child, and as I was a friend, I couldn't sleep that night, but the next day I reported to my headquarters. At this time, I was struggling with real issues in my life. I had done something very wrong, and it was carried the death penalty in Islam law. I went to Islamic scholars to see if there was a way I could find forgiveness, and they said no. There was nothing I could do. No amount of praying or good deeds would make any difference. Soon after, I visited Tom Ward again, and we talked about Islam and Christianity. Tom gave me a New Testament and explained that Jesus Christ died on the cross to forgive our sins. This was all new to me. Late that night, I read from the Gospel of John and began to understand that on the cross, Jesus died for my sins, to take the blame I deserved to be punished for. I decided to put my trust in Jesus. Since I made his decision, I have real joy in my heart, knowing Jesus is something great. Jesus set me free, and I feel really great. I feel really happy, and I'm contented. I cannot say this through words. It's all about love. His love for me. It's a great joy and a tremendous thing that I cannot utter in a few sentences. It needs a lot of pages and I ink to write about His mercy and grace and sacrifice on the cross. Jesus set me free, and I feel really great. I feel really happy and contented. So that's Ali there, a Muslim that came to know the Lord. One of the arguments that Muslim apologists use is that the Gospels are all the same, that Matthew, Mark, Luke copied off Mark all 90%. That's an argument that Muslims apologists use, but if you read Luke chapter 7, 41, 43, chapter 10, verse 30, 37, chapter 11, verse 5, 13, chapter 12, verse 6 to 21, chapter 12, 35, 40, chapter 12, 42, 48, chapter 13, 6 and 9, chapter 14, verse 6 to 24, chapter 14, 25 to 35, chapter 15, verse 8 to 10, chapter 15, verse 11 to 32, chapter 16, 1 to 13, chapter 16, 19, 31, chapter 17, 7 to 10, chapter 18, 1 to 8, chapter 18, 9 to 14, chapter 19, 11 to 27. Those are all parables that are not in the Gospel of Mark, showing you that Luke is an independent historical witness to who Jesus is. So this argument that there's 90% of Mark in Luke or in Matthew, it doesn't tell you all the information that's in Luke that's not in Mark, showing you that Luke's independent, and the same with Matthew. In Matthew, you have three chapters of the Sermon on the Mount, which is not in Mark, showing you that Mark is an independent historical source. So that argument doesn't bear, is no good. But that argument is used a lot by a Muslim apologist in Hyde Park called Hamza. And then the last point, and then we'll finish. Much more we could talk about. Some contradictions in the Quran. Surah 32:35, He directeth the ordinances from heaven unto earth, then it descended unto him in the day whereof the measure is 1,000 years of that ye reckon. God's day is 50,000 years. Surah 40 verse 4, whereby the angel and the spirit ascend unto him in a day whereof the span is 50,000 years. So there are contradictions in the Quran. Muslims say Muhammad is in the Bible. It says in Quran 7:157, those who follow the messenger, the unlettered prophet, whom they find mentioned in their own scripture, in the law of the gospel. Muslims say that the word comforter is Muhammad in John 14 and 15. But if you read, I ask all Muslims to read John chapter 14 and 15 and find how horrible that argument is, that it's just not honest. If you read John chapter 14, 15 and 16, when it uses the word comforter, it's on about the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, not about Muhammad. Just read the context. And then when Muslims quote the last chapter of Deuteronomy and say that's a prophecy of Muhammad, it says a prophet unto like Moses. Well, Moses instituted the sacrifices. Jesus came to be a sacrifice. So where did Muhammad give a sacrifice for his sin? Or teach sacrifice? It's not a major plank of his teaching and his life, but Jesus' major plank was giving his life as sacrifice, and Moses' main plank in his life was having the sacrifices of the Day of Atonement. So that's just an example of Muslim apologetics failing when it uses the Bible. We could go into a lot more information and detail, but I just want to give there are 89 confirmed historical probable facts in the Gospel of John by Craig Blugenberg, the historical reliability of John's Gospel. The Bible is more historically reliable than the Quran. So, you know, on the life of Jesus, what historical facts does the Quran say? The Gospels say much more historical facts. So, Blumberg says, archaeology confirms the use of the stone water jars in New Testament times. John 2:6 gives an early Christian tendency towards asceticism. The wine miracle is an unlikely invention. John 2:8, archaeology confirms the proper place of Jacob's well. John 4:6, Josephus' wars of the Jews 2:2-3 confirms there was significant hostility between Jews and Samaritans during Jesus' time. That's in John 4:9. Come down accurately describes the topography of Western Galilee. There's a significant elevation drop from Cana to Capernaum. John 4:46, 49:5-1. And you can read for yourself 59 confirmed historical probable facts in the Gospel of John by Craig Blumberg. The Historical Reliability of John's Gospel Issues and Commentary, Craig L. Blumberg. So, the Quran doesn't have the historical information about Jesus the way the Gospels have. It's full, packed of historical information that's accurate, way, way above the Quran, okay? And then finally, when Muslim apologists attack the Bible, they go against the Quran. Read these verses. Surah 3, 3 to 14. Surah 3, 84. Surah 7, 157. Surah 6, 114, 15. Surah 18, 27. Surah 5, 43. Surah 5, 47. Surah 5, 68. Surah 10, 94. Surah 46, 12, 42, 7. Surah 6, 155, 157. All those verses teach the Quran is saying that the Bible has not changed, that it's authoritative. So read all those verses in the Quran. Okay, I finish now. I just ask you as Muslims to think about Jesus as your Saviour. John the Baptist said that, he says, "Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world." And I've just answered some of your Muslim apologists in Hyde Park. And you might agree with me, disagree with me, but at least go and study the verses that I've quoted. Go and do the research yourself and look into it. But when you meet these Muslim apologists in Hyde Park, you know, be very, very careful what they're saying. Go and check things out for yourself. And just because they get Christians in the corner and ask these clever questions where they corner Christians, that's not no way to do things. When I debate Muslim youth, I debate Muslim youth a lot on the streets. I debate a lot of them, right? And an example is, there was a young guy recently, a few weeks ago, I debated, and he didn't understand anything. He didn't really understand anything about Islam or even Christianity. But I didn't make a fool of him. I didn't try to corner him and get him on camera and make him look an idiot. I actually protected him and defended him when people were laughing at him. I actually protected him and defended him and really honoured the guy. But the Muslim apologists don't do that. They just want to get Christians in a corner and humiliate them. And knowing that many of these Christians don't know the stuff. They're not people like me who've done a lot of research before I go down to Hyde Park. And I'm not like that. I don't do that to Muslim youth. I don't pick on them like that. I've debated lots of Muslim youth and I've treated them really fairly. And I've not given them all my best arguments or all my best evidences. I've just given them enough to make them think. But I don't humiliate them. And a lot of these Muslim apologists in Hyde Park try to humiliate Christians. And it's not right. And so I'm asking you as Muslims today to be just more open-minded, to study the Bible, read it with an open mind, to go and research things with an open mind, go to the scholarship of all sides and read it. Not just get a Zaki Naik or a Didat pamphlet or a Zaki Naik pamphlet and think that's it, you've got the arguments. That's pseudo-scholarship. But go and read the Christian apologists. Go to Answering Islam. Go to David Wood's channel, Apologetic 17. Go and listen to Jay Smith. Go and listen to James White. These are Christian apologists. But then go and read early sources, historical information, and research it yourself. Thank you for listening, and I hope this has been a blessing. If I've been offensive in any way, I didn't mean to be offensive. I'm just trying to produce the truth, what I think is the truth, and I hope this has made you think about things and research things, and I hope that you come to know the Lord Jesus as your Saviour. So thank you for listening, and God bless you. Thank you.